Audible Inc. presents Beating the Global Odds, High Stakes Decision-Making for Success, written by Paul A. Laudicina, narrated by Tristan Morris.
Introduction. Seizing the future is, fortunately, not a game of chance. If you're looking for a roadmap to a better future for your company, your country, our world, and your career and personal life, I trust this book will help. Today's society, a swirl of businesses, governments, organizations of all kinds, and individuals, has been rendered confused and paralyzed by a multitude of shocks, crises, and high-speed changes that we are all more familiar with than we'd like to be. A technology-driven and connected world has exponentially increased our inputs and choices. At the same time, there is a lack of a fundamental, shared sense of purpose on which people and organizations can build things that last. Inspiring and sparking actions that will yield longer-term benefits, both within and across borders. We can't, nor would we want to, turn back the tide of connective technologies. Instead, we need to leverage them to solve the very problems they helped spawn. Information Technology 1.0 has enabled a transaction-based society in which the deal became more important than the value it drove or the relationships it was based on. And so, this decoupling of wealth creation from value creation is at the heart of today's increasingly angry, divided, alienated, and atomized societies. In this environment, individuals have retreated from integration, seeking refuge in the realities of their identity, nationality, ethnicity, religion. Yet, we know that narrow thinking impedes innovation, and innovation drives value creation, which in turn drives wealth generation. Wealth generation enriches business, government, society, and individuals. And we know that diversity of ideas and inclusion of people drive innovation, which in turn are extended by further advances in technologies that span time and space. Only inspired leadership can help our post-Great Recession atomized society rise above itself to realize a new, rising tide prosperity. To inspire and compel purposeful action, leaders must be grounded in values and be able to pragmatically employ the best of technology and new ways of thinking. This renewed sense of can-do pragmatism must help create the future by enabling it, complementing leadership with similarly thoughtful followership. Unless there is a deeper understanding of the consequences of inaction or improper action, the promise of daring to reach beyond the constraints of time and space to seize opportunity and manage risk will not be reached. Today's leaders and citizens have to accept a world fraught with volatility and disruptive change, and they have to realize that inaction is not a good option. It's not all bad. This unprecedented volatility is accompanied by an equally unprecedented and compelling convergence of doing well with doing good, a blending of the pursuit of enlightened self-interest with the pursuit of the common good. Successful leaders will need to understand and act on this converging value proposition. By leveraging new technological capabilities and employing more dynamic ways of thinking and inspiring the future, we can beat the global odds. Coalface credentials. Coal mines are tough places to work, especially if you're working the mining equipment at the exposed seam of a coal-deep underground. The coalface. In Australia, and some other places, the expression at the coalface means you're doing something, not just talking about it hypothetically or speculating about it from a comfortable distance. Given the nature of this audiobook, I think you, the reader, deserve to know something about me before we get too much further. I don't come from a traditional consulting background. A former seminarian, I studied political science at Chicago, worked for a large oil company, and entered politics before joining a think tank, and much later, beginning my current professional career in management consulting. Even in 1992, the year I joined A.T. Kearney and founded the Global Business Policy Council, there were those who felt an insufficiently technical and business-focused background was not a good fit for the hard-edged world of global business. 20 years on, how much more difficult is it for a young liberal arts type to enter the professional world? On the other hand, technical knowledge becomes obsolete quickly. While the ability to think critically and write and speak well, the skills a liberal arts education provides, pays dividends for a lifetime. When polymath Mortimer Adler helped found the Aspen Institute in 1950, critics doubted that CEOs would have any interest in reading great literature and probing the big questions, even in the bucolic setting of Aspen, Colorado. Turns out they were interested, as even business leaders of that relatively conformist era realized that technical and managerial expertise in one's industry was a necessary but insufficient basis for making sense of what was happening in the world and for making sound decisions. This book is about a journey. My personal journey, my professional journey, my firm's journey, my client's journey, and, I hope, the listener's journey. I write this book in part to help understand and illuminate a personal and professional crossroads I have come to. As the saying goes, you don't know what you really think until you are forced to write it down. I've spent half a century living in and being enriched by three worlds: a largely contemplative world of spirituality from my youthful years studying for the priesthood, which did not turn out to be what I was called to do; a highly inquisitive and externally engaged political world of my early career in government and policy-related positions; and a more mature commercial world, working in business to help set strategic direction and meet corporate objectives for my clients and my firm. These worlds often moved in independent and concentric orbits, almost as if they were governed by their own magnetic fields, coexisting without crossing each other's wake, except under unusual and often quite dramatic circumstances. These separate and distinct domains operated in a relatively stable, steady state of independence from one another until the wonders of technology began to erode the natural boundaries and borders separating these worlds. More generally, the forces of technology fueled the ever more rapid and cost-effective movement of people, goods, capital, and ideas. These many forces, in turn, broke the pressure lock separating all these worlds, making them even more vulnerable and important to one another's ability to deliver on each of their own special missions. A quick tour of this book, and why I'm emphasizing the renaissance of scenario planning. I'll admit, it's not enough to note that people and organizations are highly frazzled from the bumps, tumbles, growing complexity, and general overload of the past few years. Tell me something I don't know, you say. In Chapter 1, however, before we can decide what to do about it, we need to unpack the whole story a bit more. As we'll see, help is actually on the way, including from such unlikely places as Santa Fe and Oxford. In the two chapters that follow, I will take you on a series of visits to other sides of the complexity coin, including the ever shorter half-life of everything, the increasingly messy and incapacitated politics of most countries, and the way in which our over-complex world has driven many ordinary people either to a state of angry populism or to just tuning out entirely. These trends are all closely connected and self-reinforcing in a negative way. To top it off, many of our brightest business minds have been giving strong incentives to game the system, creating no lasting value and even offloading risks and losses onto society at large. If this is capitalism, Adam Smith would find it unrecognizable. So, you might think, let's just wait until the smoke clears and the economy bounces back fully before committing ourselves to any definitive course of action. That might be an instinctive reaction to today's chaotic mixed signals, but I will advocate that inaction, or staying in neutral, would be the wrong choice, and a very big missed opportunity. In the succeeding chapters of the book, I will give you a brisk spin around some remarkable ideas, places, companies, and people who are definitely not waiting for some El Dorado of boom times to reemerge from the ashes of the Great Recession. Behind the scenes, they are innovating like mad, lightening the material content of everything, simplifying and curating the interface where people connect with products, services, organizations, and governments, and repairing social fabric wherever relationships and bonds of trust have been frayed, which is pretty much everywhere. In the final part of the book, I will try to give you a peek into where to prospect for new ideas and insights, how to use, and not misuse, expert opinion, why you should widen your lens of inputs in a discerning way, and lastly, how and when to deploy serious foresight disciplines, such as scenario planning, whether for professional or personal high-stakes decision-making. As I will emphasize later, there is only one past and one present, but there are multiple possible futures for you, your organization, and our world. Happily, seizing the future is not a game of chance or fate, but rather much more a matter of skill and foresight. And thinking about the future in the right way is really about informing present decisions with a fresh sense of the possible. Scenario planning, which was born in the Cold War period of thinking the unthinkable, and later played a significant role in various attempts to make sense of economic turbulence and oil shocks, is enjoying a rebirth with corporations and governments as they try to anticipate what might lie ahead. After all, who wouldn't prefer fresh thinking and insights and a new sense of purposeful action to the alternative of staleness and shell shock? But scenario planning, or scenario-based strategic planning as it might be better termed, is a real discipline that needs to be learned before it can be applied, much as you would need to learn accounting, or vascular surgery, or in fact anything, before attempting to do it, or even before you become a consumer of someone else's scenarios. I will do my best to show you the way. What's Different, What Never Changes, and A Tale of Two Cities. Reality is always more complex, and faster changing, than any attempt to sloganize it, or to try to force fit some paradigm or acronym. When I was a university student, the work of pioneering psychologist and philosopher William James had a major impact on my thinking. James, the father of American pragmatism, recognized that you first needed to accept and believe something before you could bring some structure to your life and thinking. For example, to make a leap of faith of some kind before you can act decisively. Pragmatism was the antidote to the rigid school of scientific materialism, the need to have empirical certitude supporting every decision. All this remains true. We are still trying to bring order to chaos. The perennial universal questions continue to gnaw at us. Read, or reread, a translation of some ancient manuscripts or papyrus, sacred or otherwise, from 3,000 years ago, and you will be amazed at how people's thoughts, hopes, and worries at the time look remarkably similar to what we think and feel today. This has not changed and probably never will. As Aristotle asserted over 2,300 years ago, all human actions have one or more of these seven causes: chance, nature, compulsion, habit, reason, passion, and desire. Some things have changed, though. What's different now is the level of complexity and velocity we are faced with in every aspect of our lives and occupations. In short, what has changed is the ramp speed. What has also changed, decreased, of course, is the level of engagement of large groups of the public, who feel, and are, adrift. The courage required to make a somewhat more difficult leap is more significant than ever, as are the eloquence and inspiration needed to encourage others to come along for the ride. If complexity and speed have increased exponentially in recent years, there is help on the way, and in some sense, it's a tale of two cities. Two unlikely places, ancient Oxford and avant-garde Santa Fe, are providing some truly breakthrough ideas about how to tame ever-increasing complexity and make it work for us, and also how advances in scenario planning and related foresight disciplines can help us think about the future and inform the present in ways that classic forecasting, polling, expert opinion, and so on never did or ever can. Santa Fe is an old place by American standards. It has the oldest government building still in use, the Palace of the Governors, the oldest church in continuous operation, the San Miguel Mission, and it just celebrated its 400th anniversary. Not to mention that this tiny state capital has the country's third largest art market by dollar value after New York and Los Angeles. But in the sparsely populated high desert of northern New Mexico, with its brilliant sunsets, you can still reinvent yourself with relative ease. When the U.S. government resolved to pursue secret work to invent an atomic bomb during World War II, it decided to use Santa Fe as the staging ground for the even more remote location of Los Alamos, about an hour away. The Manhattan Project, as it was called, in turn forced scientists and government strategists to confront entirely new questions of life and death on a previously unimaginable scale. Thinking the unthinkable, in the words of Herbert Kahn of the Hudson Institute, whose work fed directly into the creation of scenario planning. In the early 1980s, according to the history of the Santa Fe Institute, provided on its website, a group of Los Alamos National Lab scientists felt a general dissatisfaction with the stovepiped, bureaucratic, funding-centric approach to science that had taken hold both at the federal laboratories and academia. And each felt that this carrot-and-stick approach of science was on a massive scale, leading their colleagues toward scientific myopia, reductionism, and stagnation. Furthermore, they believed some of science's biggest questions, those that required a more expansive perspective, were going unanswered to the detriment of science and mankind. So the Santa Fe Institute was born as a standalone, transdisciplinary research institute. This was not an entirely new idea. 100 years ago, when the world's top brain power hubs were the 10 or so leading German universities, Kaiser Wilhelm II, despite his many faults, had the interesting idea to create an elite, standalone research institute, which survives today as the group of well-regarded Max Planck Institutes. In North America, the Independent Institute for Advanced Study was created in 1930 near Princeton University and attracted luminaries such as Albert Einstein. But it wasn't until the 1980s and 1990s that the new Santa Fe Institute, SFI, established itself as one of the world's leading centers for research across disciplines and, indeed, in the vacant space between disciplines. Today, research and insights coming out of SFI give us hope that the complexity that is currently overwhelming us can be tamed and harnessed for good by use of the very instruments that have created this complexity. I will tell you more about that later. As for Oxford University, it's on the other side of the timescale. It's so old that no one even knows the approximate year when it was founded. Teaching has gone on there since around 1096, the better part of 1,000 years. But, as the saying goes, something isn't good because it's old. It's very old because it's very good. Unlike most universities that are relatively centralized and highly structured by school and department, Oxford remains an eccentrically assembled, loose confederation of independent colleges, halls, facilities, units, and centers of various kinds. Although it was very late to the business school scene, founding a business school in 1996, long after management studies had become respectable elsewhere, it has now carved out the world's preeminent niche in scenario planning and related foresight disciplines. Along with its sister university, Cambridge, it's the only institution that has managed to stay in the world's top tier for literally centuries and is still going strong. But why? There are a number of reasons for Oxford's continuing importance, including its being an important intellectual focal point for the entire English-speaking world. But there's more to it. Oxford's loose confederation means that the disciplinary stovepipes are less rigid than they are elsewhere. In Oxford's 38 separate colleges, marketing professors and poetry scholars dine with astrophysicists and theologians each night. Over such delicacies, for acquired tastes, as potted shrimp, reform cutlets, and orange fool. One well-endowed historic college, All Souls, has no students at all, only faculty members, known as fellows, who are given the gift of free time and staff support to use as they see fit. And, even as a very old institution, Oxford relishes the constant infusion of fresh blood. Cecil Rhodes's famous scholarship program has brought some particularly talented new blood to the place every year since 1902. One such person was a brilliant scholar and cricketer who came from the far reaches of Western Australia in 1974, Rod Eddington, who went on to lead Cathay Pacific Airlines and later British Airways. Sir Rod, as he now is, came back to Oxford in 2003 to speak to a large group of Rhodes Scholars and Oxford MBA students. He reminisced about the place and about the essential need for suppleness in our thinking and action, to avoid veins that become clogged and a mindset that becomes crusty and sclerotic, and to demonstrate that doing well and doing good must go together. Whatever his faults, the basis of Rhodes scholarship was selection on merit. Neither race, religion, or need were to be taken into account. He counted moral qualities as well as intellectual ones, and admired the instinct for public service as highly as anything else. If history teaches us anything, and we can only hope it does, there is a way ahead that should be obvious to us. If the West is to retain its position, we have to be inclusive. We must not make the mistake of thinking that everybody thinks as we do. There is tension between the center and the edges, between head office and the outposts, between the World Trade Organization and the world's traders, from Calcutta to Qatar. That's the essence of organization, and I suggest it has some very important implications for our global system, too. Unless those arrangements deliver unequivocal benefits for countries less powerful and rich than our own, we will start depending more on force and less on persuasion. It doesn't work. If we lose suppleness, we'll lose the game. Chapter 1. Global Brain Freeze. Nonstop overstimulation brings disorientation. If you're going through hell, keep going. Sir Winston Churchill. You know the feeling. At the end of a long flight, the wheels touch down, and you instinctively reach for your iPhone or BlackBerry, pressing the on button even before the reverse thrust kicks in. Within about 10 seconds, if you're lucky, your device picks up a signal, and then the messages start streaming in, each one giving your already overstimulated brain a dopamine hit. Maybe if you've just arrived in Mumbai after a 14-hour flight, you've got literally hundreds of incoming emails, a dozen voicemails, and bad economic news to process and react to. Global markets may have plunged again while you were trying to doze during the second meal service. Perhaps you're grateful that aircraft don't yet universally have in-flight Wi-Fi configured, or you wouldn't have gotten any chance to rest at all. In the sedan on your way to the hotel, you try to hack your way through some of the messages, answering those that only require a quick response and preferably little thought. UCLA psychiatrist Gary Small's research shows that this continuous partial attention actually leads to a kind of brain fog, where much information is skimmed, but nothing useful really sticks. You make a mental note to yourself. Does answering email for 10 hours a day constitute productive work? Or, for that matter, a productive life? Fortunately, or otherwise, neither you nor I have time to dwell on that question. We need to keep rolling. One foot in front of the other. More has become much less. I don't claim to be a prophet, and in fact, I know I still spend far too much time reacting to incoming developments rather than anticipating them. On the other hand, in 2005, I authored a book entitled World Out of Balance. Despite the continuing halcyon days of economic boom, I took the then unfashionable view that all was not well with the world and gave some specific advice about what business leaders needed to do to adapt their companies and, more importantly, their thinking to some volatile new realities. In hindsight, I wish I had been dead wrong about the future that would unfold. 7 years on, the pace of change has only accelerated, and rather than being brought back into balance, our world has undergone a further series of upheavals that have shaken us to the core. Not surprisingly, people and organizations everywhere are feeling disoriented, bewildered, and even paralyzed. From crisis and scandal to the proliferation of product choice and the relentless 24/7 information smog of always-on news, email, and social media, we are not feeling especially smarter or wiser. On the contrary, our ability to think and act decisively with the future in mind has diminished. Imagine having, at last, the entire knowledge of human civilization at your fingertips, and finding that it basically gives you a migraine. Michael Lederer, an American writer who lives in Berlin and Dubrovnik, Croatia, son of a dear late friend of mine, calls this Mundo Overlodus, the title of his recent play that premiered in New York. There is something you can do about it, but first, you have to understand it. You won't be alone, as a considerable amount of effort is being put into this endeavor by a number of innovative firms. One of the principles behind Google, for example, is to use technology to more effectively sort, categorize, and manage information on a vast scale. While Google is widely considered one of the most successful and admired companies of our time, even its current approaches to innovation may be nearing their natural limit. Sophisticated tools to track users' behaviors and preferences and to match them with the closest content providers have had the unintended consequence of limiting results to a too narrow and self-selecting range, while clever companies have found ways to manipulate their own content so that it shows up higher in search results. Google recognizes this and is constantly attempting to update its algorithms accordingly. But one wonders if this cat-and-mouse game will go on indefinitely. The point is not made to single out or pick on Google. It's a brilliant company filled with bright and creative people. Rather, the problem stems from addressing a new challenge with an old paradigm. The old paradigm tells us that as the volume of information increases, the capacity of the organizational system adapts to accommodate it. Throughout history, from the ancient Library of Alexandria, Egypt, to Gutenberg's movable type-enabled printing, to the Dewey Decimal System and the personal computer, and now to Google, this has been the case. Like competing Cold War adversaries, the arms race between the expansion of knowledge and the systems to organize it has historically been in balance. New tools, faster processors, larger data centers, and mobile devices connected to high-speed wireless data networks work behind the scenes to ensure that wherever you are not left without a digital assistant. All these things have helped to make the immense and ongoing expansion of the world's body of knowledge an asset to leverage, rather than an albatross around the neck. In today's world, however, this has changed for two reasons. First, with the geometric expansion of available knowledge and the increasing diversity of ways to deliver and access it, we are past the point where new tools can be developed in enough time to keep pace, at least for now. The second is that regardless of the capacity or technological sophistication of our tools, later in this volume I will discuss how technology is evolving to help tame technology. The volume and velocity of information increases geometrically, but our ability to understand and act upon that information explosion chugs behind linearly. No longer can the information surge be managed solely through superior organization. Rather, a wholesale new way of thinking, behaving, and discerning is necessary to manage and cope with the pace of change and disruption. In a sense, this represents a new limit to the utility of technology. Even the best systems will be limited by the capacity of individuals and society to usefully absorb the data surge and then, with wisdom, to know what to do with it. I'm not advocating that you cut your cables and smash your smartphone, although there are those intent on doing just that. Taking a page from Henry David Thoreau and his self-imposed isolation at Walden Pond, author and media analyst Dr. Thomas Cooper says that the only healthy response to fast media is a media fast, a kind of detox for the mind. I think a better approach for most people is what Kevin Cashman, senior partner of a big league executive search and talent management firm, Korn Ferry, calls the pause principle, which is also the title of his excellent new book. Effective leaders, or in fact effective people in any occupation, simply do not zoom at warp speed continuously. Finding the right time to pause, think, reflect, recharge, and be creative is absolutely essential to success in any field. In what Kevin calls our relentless VUCA world, an acronym for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, originally coined by the U.S. Army War College, we all need to find some time to pause regularly in order to refresh our minds, bodies, and thinking, and to take stock of things overlooked in the hubbub of daily life and work. It's largely forgotten now, but the late German thinker Joseph Pieper he died in 1997, published a highly contrarian and countercultural work in 1952 called Leisure, The Basis of Culture, with no less than T.S. Eliot writing the introduction to the English language edition. Pieper's view was that everything that we value about human civilization requires surplus capital and surplus leisure time, properly used. Even in the early 1950s, he could write, "In our Western world, total labor has vanquished leisure. Unless we regain the art of silence and thought, the ability for creative non-activity, unless we substitute true leisure for our hectic amusements, we will destroy our culture and ourselves." Strong words, to be sure, but he was probably onto something. John Gage, former chief scientist of Sun Microsystems, likes to quip that an astonishingly high percentage of important new discoveries, inventions, and creative works are made by people who don't have to go to meetings. Another interesting data point is the popularity of the Waldorf School of the peninsula of Los Altos, California, among the super-achieving parents of Silicon Valley. Guess what? Computers, cell phones, and iPads are strictly forbidden to these children of the tech elite, in favor of pens, pencils, and yes, knitting needles. Maybe you recall a certain creative college dropout who taught himself calligraphy rather than computer programming and took the time out to get in touch with his inner self before going on to set the world on fire. His name, of course, was Steve Jobs. The pause principle, and corollaries such as the returning popularity of the Walden Pond getting away from it all concept, speak to the intuitive receptivity of these ideas with most people. Nearly everyone is in agreement that the demands of modern life and the modern workplace are such that more reflective activities are squeezed out, and that this is not a good thing. Part of the reason behind the continuing resonance of our A.T. Kearney Global Business Policy Council CEO retreat program is that the executives who attend find value, for one or two long weekends per year, in the chance to step off the merry-go-round and think about and learn about broad, far-reaching concepts and trends from different vantage points that they are simply denied the opportunity to focus on otherwise. Yet the fact that Thoreau wrote about this need to unplug and recharge over 160 years ago, and Pieper 60 years ago, tells us that the challenge of finding clear thought in a modern context, while perhaps accelerating from Thoreau to Pieper to now, is hardly new. So the question remains, why, despite recognition of the need, has this problem remained with us, and why have we been unable to do anything about it? The types of big picture, high concept questions likely to be asked by a more broadly inclined thinker are far less reassuring than those offered by a precise, solutions-driven, technical mind. When time is short and deadlines are tight, who wouldn't prefer a sharp, penciled answer to a broad brushstroke question? Yet the overconfidence furnished by analytical certitude in a fluid and rapidly changing world can be disastrous. John S. Hammond, Ralph L. Keeney, and Howard Rafa, in their important 1998 Harvard Business Review piece, The Hidden Traps in Decision-Making, would call this the estimating and forecasting trap. Overconfidence in a clear conception of the future that could be wrong, rather than planning around a more flexible view. This is not meant in any way to disparage the contributions that talented engineers and highly skilled technicians make to organizations, businesses, and governments around the world. It is simply a plea for greater balance in the skills that we value both as business leaders and as a society. Today's world is too complex to manage without the technical abilities of engineers and scientists, but it is too unpredictable and still too little understood not to incorporate the integrative perspectives of different thinking styles. Success requires the technical and the intuitive, as well as the pragmatic acknowledgement that we must act without waiting for that ever-elusive, and in fact never attained, certainty about every aspect of what we're doing or seeking. Think pinball, not roulette. As for the past few roller coaster years, you wouldn't be human if you didn't also feel some sense of dread, given the relentless stream of changes, shocks, and crises affecting everything from your retirement nest egg to your children's career options. By dread, I mean the kind of apprehension that is nasty and visceral, right to the gut, and makes you feel like a bystander with little or no control over the forces shaping your life. Oscar Wilde said more than a century ago, "To expect the unexpected shows a thoroughly modern intellect." But he surely meant that as a bit of a joke. Since the sudden decompression of the world economy in 2007, no joke to us, analysts and pundits have been working and talking overtime to make sense of it all. Some blame too much leverage and easy credit, others too little regulation, and still others the proliferation of exotic financial...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.